Good morning. Welcome. Let's stand together and worship. Let's sing together.
Joyful, joyful.
Isn't he wonderful?
sing hallelujah, Christ is risen. Bow down before Him, for He is Lord of all. Sing hallelujah, Christ is risen.
Father, we are joyful to be in your house today. We do come to the altar to worship you, expecting your presence in our midst, offering you our time, our talents, and our monetary gifts to further your kingdom. Open our hearts and our minds and our ears to hear your message today, we pray. In Christ Jesus, the cornerstone's name, we pray. Amen. And a good morning from Kids Street as well. If there are any kids in the congregation, they can come down to the steps for the kids' message. So you're pretty mobile now, huh? So you went from a scooter to a cast, and now you've got your Velcro boot, huh?
A cast, then a new knee scooter, and then a boot, and then a walker, and then nothing.
Now you're just running around with that thing, huh? Can't keep you down, can they? No. All right. Well, I've got something here for you. If I gave you like this, could you tell me what that puzzle is of?
Maybe outside.
Think it may be outside. If I gave you another one, what if I gave you that? Could you tell what that was a puzzle to?
No.
No, right? So I'm looking at a couple puzzle pieces. I really can't tell.
These don't look that like they go together.
They don't even look like they go together, right? It's just a couple pieces. We really can't.
This is a different puzzle, and this is to a different.
I think that one's to a different puzzle, even, huh? All right. So, what if I gave you this much? Could you tell what this is gonna make?
Maybe a Royals Stadium.
Ooh, you are pretty darn close. Did you hear that? She said a stadium, Royals Stadium. It's a football stadium from where I grew up. So that was a pretty good guess, right? So as we're doing a puzzle, do you peek at the picture that they give you?
Does that
yes.
help?
Yes.
Yeah, peeking at the picture helps, right? That helps us see what it's supposed to look like when we're all done, right?
Even though it might not be as big as the real puzzle, but it still helps you look, know what it looks like.
Yeah. So we're here at church, okay? And we're learning about what our lives should look like. What do we look at to figure out how we should live? Yeah, say it.
God.
That's right, okay? Jesus Christ is that picture for our life. Where do we study about Jesus's life?
In the Bible.
That's right. So the Bible's kind of like our picture to our puzzle, right?
It doesn't look like this.
Well, no, it's not a stadium.
Yeah.
Some people might compare it to that, but not really. And having the Bible and learning about Jesus' life helps us to see, you know, how our life should be, you know, what it should look like when we are Christians, how we should love one another. So I just want you to think of that puzzle today as you're not listening to Pastor Kevin this morning, you're going to listen to me twice. All right, so why don't you bow with me, and then we will worship the Lord that gives us our picture. Dear Lord, we thank you for helping us navigate the puzzle that is our lives and giving us an example of what our lives should look like, a picture of your perfect love through Jesus Christ. Help us to share that love with those around us, we pray. In Jesus' name, amen.
Let's stand together as we continue to worship. This is 184 in your red hymnal, if you'd like to read from there.
Jesus is all the world to me, my life, my joy, my all. He is my strength from day to day, without him I would fall. When I am sad, to him I go, no other one can cheer me so.
The sweetest of loves, when my heart with me, please. Dear Lord, thank you for all of the gifts that you have bestowed upon all of us, whether those are talents, money, just the ability to do your work. Let us hear the words. Let us be good stewards of our money. And in your name we pray. Amen.
Wonderful sense of worship we're being able to experience through the praise band and his presence. It's a joy to share with you this morning while Rev Kev's on vacation. It's a blessing to him that he's able to have family time, and I've come to enjoy spending some time preparing. I was looking at his sermon series that he's in the middle of in between weeks 7 and 8, so I'm going to do week 7.5. he's doing This Is Us, Reasons We Follow Jesus, and this morning we'll be looking at God Helps Us by Giving Us Belonging. And those are the three scriptures if you want to put a thumb in those. Okay, there we go. It's looking at a deep and essential need that each of us have, that need to belong. We see it played out throughout human history and just as prevalent in today's society. We have people joining clubs, organizations, gangs and groups, teams and activities, all to feel a sense of belonging. Nate has played a song from one of my favorite artists in another sermon that I shared on Solomon. The song is entitled Wholehearted, and it's by the group Extreme, and the chorus sings, "There's a hole in my heart that can only be filled by you. And this hole in my heart can't be filled with the things I do. Solomon tried to fill that hole with power, with knowledge, with wealth, with women, but none of them satisfied his longing, a longing that God has placed in our hearts, and a longing that he lovingly fulfills. This sense of belonging he gives us is a profound and reassuring aspect of our relationship with God. It's not just a comforting feeling, it's a divine gift that helps us navigate the trials and the joys of life. So let's explore how God provides this sense of belonging through his word and how we can apply it in our daily lives. We belong to God's family. If you read along with me from Ephesians 2, 19 through 22. Consequently, you are no longer foreigners and strangers, but fellow citizens with God's people and also members of his household, built on the foundation of the apostles and prophets, with Christ Jesus himself as the cornerstone. In him, the whole building is joined together and rises to become a holy temple in the Lord. And in him, you too are being built together to become a dwelling in which God lives by his Spirit. Well, Paul said it best, so there, that's it. That's my sermon. You guys have a good Sunday. the verse by verse there, Paul reminds us that through Christ, the moment we accept him into our hearts, we are no longer outsiders. The Bible Dictionary defines a citizen as one who enjoys municipal rights and duties and protection under the law. Paul was allowed certain privileges deemed worthy due to his citizenship. Our worth is in our citizenship in Christ's kingdom, not what we do or how much we earn or what we look like or how many followers we have or what we wear. As we willingly live our life by God's commands, not only are we granted citizenship, we are brought into God's household, and we belong to a new family. This is not just a metaphorical family. It is a reality where each believer plays a vital role. The Bible describes us as fellow citizens with God's people. This means we have a place where we are accepted and valued. So, belonging to God's family, I had a puzzle with Skylar at the front. If you think about that jigsaw puzzle, every piece is placed in the box by the maker. Each piece is unique and must fit into a specific place. But by looking at just one piece, you can't see the entire picture. And without one piece, the picture isn't complete. Similarly, in God's family, each one of us is essential. Our individual contributions, our unique gifts, and even our struggles, when placed together, create a beautiful picture of the church, the body of Christ. So how do we respond? Next slide, please. Embrace your role in the church community, whether it's serving on the worship team, the media team, teaching Bible study, encouraging others, welcoming guests, picking up the offerings, counting the offerings, praying, sewing quilts, fixing the building, gardening, helping at Hillcrest, serving on committees, comforting the grieving, collecting items, giving offerings, or just simply being present. Remember that you are an indispensable part of God's family. In most puzzles, there isn't a giant, big, shiny piece in the middle of the puzzle that's more important than all the rest. We are all equally citizens, equally loved by our Creator. Reach out to others in the church. Foster relationships. Support one another. This interconnectedness is a tangible expression of our belonging. Not only are we members of His household, as mentioned in Ephesians, we are actually adopted into God's family. In Romans 8, 14 and 17, you can read, "For those who are led by the Spirit of God are the children of God. The Spirit you receive does not make you slaves so that you live in fear again. Rather, the Spirit you received brought about your adoption to sonship. And by Him we cry, 'Abba, Father.' The Spirit Himself testifies with our spirit that we are God's children. Now, if we are children, then we are heirs, heirs of God and co-heirs with Christ. If we indeed share in His sufferings in order that we may also share in His glory." The concept of adoption is powerful. It means that God chose us. We are not His children by accident or by birthright, but by His deliberate choice. This choice is rooted in love and gives us a secure place in His heart and kingdom. I am a fourth grade teacher, and this year I did social emotional learning along with social studies and science. And I used Steve Hartman's On the Road series from CBS videos in my classroom this year to teach kindness and many other attributes of citizenship. I showed this story on the last day of school, and it was truly a blessing. So let's see if it works.
As we prepare to celebrate our nation's birthday, we're reminded that it's a moment to reflect and appreciate just how far we've come. Here's CBS's Steve Hartman on the road.
What may look like a house to you is something much more magnificent to the boy inside.
What did you think when you saw this place for the first time?
We said it's second heaven.
Second heaven?
Yes. You pass through this before you go to the big heaven. That is what I believe so.
He means that, literally. And why wouldn't he? Abraham and his brother James are from Sierra Leone. They were homeless before finding their way to an orphanage and eventually to their new family outside Charlotte, North Carolina. Oh. Joe and Jamie Walker adopted them last fall. And they say the boys have been wide-eyed with wonder ever since.
It's hard. Every little thing we take for granted. Coming home from the airport, and I hit the button to open our front gate.
Everything's magic to them. It's magic.
Whether it's a present just showing up on Christmas morning, or something mundane like a car wash, the kids are constantly blown away.
But the biggest surprise, the most profound reaction, happened last month on Abraham's 12th birthday. You had birthdays before you came here. How did you celebrate them?
That would be a crazy question.
Why is that a crazy question?
I never celebrate them. I never knew it was my birthday.
Happy birthday!
So when the song started and his mom appeared with that glowing tribute, Abraham was overwhelmed.
When I see the cake, I thought that is the most beautiful thing I've ever seen.
The birthday cake.
It's not just a birthday cake. It's a blessing cake.
A blessing cake. And what a blessing it is that once a year, friends and family gather just to honor our existence. Most of us take that for granted, but not in this house. Not anymore.
Just be reminded that we need to stop and be super grateful for what we do have.
A good wish for America from this American dream.
Yeah.
come true. Steve Hartman, on the road, in Charlotte.
That was hard to keep a dry eye in our last class meeting. Abraham had never celebrated a birthday before. He was adopted and moved to the U.S., so when his mom appeared with a cake for his most recent birthday, he became overwhelmed with emotion. "It's not just a birthday cake. It's a blessing cake," he said. Abraham and his brother James were orphans who are now adopted into a loving family. They might have felt lost or alone, but once adopted, they received love and care and a sense of identity. They were once without a home or security. Now they have a place to belong and a family name and an inheritance. Similarly, God adopts us into his family, giving us a new identity as his children. We are not just guests in his house or citizens in his household. We are family members, sons and daughters. This transformation from orphan to child mirrors our spiritual adoption to God's family. So how do we respond? Live with confidence that you are a beloved child of God. This identity is unshakable. When you face challenges or feel isolated, remind yourself of this truth. Our family repeated a saying as kids were getting old enough to leave the house and go do things on their own. Remember who you are and whose you are. Consider your first and your last name. Be true to yourself and to your family. Just as we have identity in Christ, and we belong to him. Even if we don't have a good relationship with our own family, we belong to him, our Heavenly Father. Look for others that need a sense of belonging and adopt them into your family, our church family, the family of believers, his family. As our circle grows, we are blessed to be used to share his love. Engage with God in prayer, addressing him as Abba, Father, and let his love and acceptance fill your heart. As well as being sons and daughters of God, we also inherit an entire family of believers. So we belong to one another. 1 Corinthians 12:12 through 14, and the ending from verse 27 says, "Just as a body, though one, has many parts, but all of its many parts form one body, so it is with Christ. For we are all baptized by one Spirit, so as to form one body. Whether Jews or Gentiles, slaves or free, and we are all given the one Spirit to drink. Even so, the body is not made up of one part, but many. Now you are the body of Christ, and each one of you is a part of it." That's a pretty popular metaphor from Paul, comparing the body to the church. It's a powerful message of unity and diversity within the church. Each member has a unique function and all necessary for the body to operate properly. It's not a building, but there's our church. The scriptures compare our church to the body of Christ. Different parts of the body, our hands, our feet, our eyes, ears, all have distinct roles. If one part fails, the whole body suffers. For example, if your foot hurts, it affects your ability to walk. impacting your overall mobility. Soon your other leg will develop issues due to overcompensating, and then your back pains will begin. I've got those. And your alignment gets out of whack. In our lobby, we have a prayer and praise board where we share our needs and our good news, where the quote is written, "Shared sorrow is half sorrow, and shared joy is double joy." These words ring true in God's church. So how do we respond? Recognize and appreciate the diversity within the church. Celebrate the different gifts and contributions of your fellow believers. We are all children of God and are gifted with talents and abilities that can glorify Him and further God's kingdom. Engage in service, Bible studies, ministries like visiting folks in the hospital, calling people you missed seeing at church, sending comforting and encouraging cards, inviting members over for meals, on trips, to fun outings and activities where you can build deeper connections and support one another, recognizing that we're interdependent. God's plan was for us to be united, for us to belong to Him, not only individually, but to each other as well. We are described as being built together to become a dwelling in which God lives by His Spirit. This means our belonging is communal, spiritual. We are meant to love and support and care for each other. For as we do, the Holy Spirit dwells with us. Matthew 18:20 reminds us, "For where two or three are gathered in my name, there I am with them." So back to that jigsaw puzzle. Each piece is unique and different, yet every piece is essential to complete the picture. We are, as members of God's family, like those puzzle pieces. Individually, we might not see the full picture, but together we form a beautiful image of God's love and grace. Many members of my childhood church and this congregation have been integral parts in my wife Rhonda's and my children's lives, from finding us jobs to teaching Sunday school, from fixing cars and homes to camping and traveling, from praying with us during a loss to celebrating weddings and the births of children, from serving on committees to hosting holiday gatherings. We all fit in each other's lives in different ways and at different times as God has ordained. These are special friendships built on the solid foundation of God's church, Christ Jesus. So we are built on Christ, the cornerstone. So revisiting Ephesians, we read in the middle of that passage there that we are built on the foundation of the apostles and the prophets with Christ Jesus Himself as the cornerstone. In Him, the whole building is joined together. Our belonging is not just a superficial membership. It's deeply rooted in Christ. He is the cornerstone upon which our faith and our sense of belonging is built. No offense, but it's not built on any musical style or preacher or building or friends. It's built on Jesus. Our connection to God and to each other is made firm and unshakable through Him. So Pastor Kevin helped me find the cornerstone to our 1895 sanctuary there. So consider the construction of a building. The cornerstone is placed, and is crucial because it ensures the stability and alignment of the entire structure. We look at the picture for guidance in a jigsaw puzzle to see where a certain piece might fit. It's our reference point. It's our answer key. In our lives, Christ is that cornerstone. No matter who the minister is, or who's in the next pew, or what hymn we sing, or where we worship and serve, he ensures that our sense of belonging is secure and enduring. Jesus even prayed for our unity. In John 17, 20 through 23, it reads, "My prayer is not for them alone. I pray also for those who will believe in me through their message, that all of them may be one. Father, just as you are in me and I am in you, may they also be in us, so that the world may believe that you have sent me. I have given them the glory that you gave me, that they may be one as we are one. I in them and you in me, so that they may be brought to complete unity. Then the world will know that you sent me and have loved them even as you have loved me." He prayed for our unity. Understanding that our sense of belonging and our witness to the world are deeply intertwined. I hear folks say, "I don't want to go to church. It's full of hypocrites." Why would folks come to church if it's the same selfish, lost place as the world? Church isn't a club for saints. It's a hospital for sinners. That's the old answer to the hypocrite's comment. We, the church as a whole, are to be busy helping each other get better instead of keeping score or judging folks. If loving on people is our identity, then the world will see how we are different, loving and living in harmony. As we build our lives on Christ as our cornerstone, we are united and reflect the oneness of the Trinity and become a powerful testimony to God's love. So there's an image of a symphony, an orchestra. You can consider our praise band as well. Each musician plays a different instrument. Yet when they play together in harmony, they create a beautiful piece of music so that no single instrument could produce on its own. Have you ever heard the warm-up before the performance? If during the performance they all play their own song in different time signatures and in different keys without a conductor, it would be chaotic. Our unity as believers is like that orchestra led by our conductor, Christ, our cornerstone, creating a beautiful testimony of God's love and grace as a witness to the world of the loving God that claims us as his children. So what's our response? Strive for unity in your relationships with other believers. This means practicing forgiveness, extending grace, and seeking reconciliation. When conflicts arise, which they will, we're human, address them with love and a desire for peace, not a desire to be right. Our unity not only strengthens us, but also serves as a compelling witness to those outside the faith. So to sum up, got to have 4 bullet points, right? Pastor Kevin isn't here, so there they are. How can we live out this sense of belonging in practical ways? Embrace your identity in Christ. Understand that you are a beloved child of God. Let this identity shape your self-worth. Remember who you are and whose you are. Foster relationships within the church. Make an effort to connect with your church family. Join service groups. Attend fellowship events. Participate in Bible study. And build meaningful relationships. Adopt each other. Serve and support each other. Just as each member of the family has roles and responsibilities, find ways to serve others in your community, whether through acts of kindness, prayer, or practical help. Contribute to the well-being of your spiritual family, the body of Christ. Share the love of Christ. Extend this sense of belonging to those outside the church. Invite others to experience the love and community you have found in Christ. The old song goes, "They will know we are Christians by our love." So as we reflect on these scriptures, we see that God helps us by giving us a profound sense of belonging. In a world where we may feel isolated and disconnected, the promise of belonging to God's family is a powerful and transformative truth. God, through Christ, has given us a place where we are loved, accepted, and valued. We have worth through Christ, in Christ. We are members of His family, adopted as His children, and are vital parts of the body of Christ. This sense of belonging is not just for our comfort, but also for our mission to the world. Let's embrace this belonging, united in love and in purpose, and live out our calling as members of God's household in tangible ways. By embracing our roles in the church, living confidently as God's children, recognizing our interdependence, and striving for unity. In doing so, we reflect the love and unity of God, drawing others to Him. Nate is going to lead us in a hymn of invitation. As we sing, "If you'd like to belong to the family of God, ask Jesus to be the cornerstone of your life and serve in the body of Christ here." Then you can come forward and share your decision with your FBC family. I'll be at the steps to visit with you. You can even visit in the lobby, or you can contact the church office. Rev Kev will return from vacation next week. Let's close in prayer. Heavenly Father, thank you for adopting us into your family and giving us a place where we truly belong. Help us to embrace our identity in Christ and build a strong, loving relationship within your church. May we support and serve one another, reflecting your love in the world around us. May we find and offer belonging in God's love and community. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
Let's stand and sing together.
Jesus is He
As we depart, please let us listen to the words that we heard, incorporate those into our daily lives, and remember that we are a reflection of the words that we hear and the actions that we do. In Jesus' name we pray, amen.